So once we have all the ideas, the main idea obviously of the show, and then a million ideas, good or bad, now it's time to figure out what we're gonna do. It's, we always talk about it's like writing an essay. Like, we've gotta have an outline because there are definite parameters within the time frame and realistic parameters of how many ideas you can really put in there. And also sometimes it's like, maybe these two ideas are great, but do they work next to each other? Is there enough variety with what's going on? So what we try to do is we try to lay out a basic time frame for each one. Hopefully the time doesn't add up too much, but we also got to make sure we give enough time to each idea.
Right.
It's a very tricky thing. We don't get too crazy with the time lengths with that, but just to help us along. The main thing is that outline, like movement 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever it's going to be. What are the feels? What's the, you know, what are we trying to accomplish? How does this all feel when you put them back to back?
In essence, it's basically, you have to know your beginning, middle, and end.
Mm-hmm.
Then you can fill out all the stuff in between. It's that simple. Like, how's your show going to begin? How's it going to end? And what are your couple of really big events in the middle? And they better have something to do with your concept.
Yeah, because it seems like most people get the very beginning and they get the very end of their shows.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like it's the journey in between the beginning and the end that really makes the difference as far as the programs that I've seen.
Right. So with our 2013 production at Chino Hills, Timeless, the generic rough outline is really important for us to be able to distill all these different ideas down into a show that works. So if you look at the show literally in the roughest possible outline, we start at the very beginning. Conceptually, we wanted to create almost this sort of Broadway overture, pre-show idea without doing a pre-show. We personally don't like doing pre-shows as much because we want the judge to judge everything we're doing. So we start off with a wave of sound bites of things that are familiar that create a sense of nostalgia, a timeless feeling that everyone has. But under that, we have a very contemporary sort of electronic groove-based drum set and very interesting front ensemble integration so that we have this very fresh, cool, and modern approach set like juxtaposed with these old references, these sound bites, and all these things that are familiar.
Time goes by without us. Some things last forever.
Stay hungry, stay foolish. I'm gonna float like a butterfly and sing like a bee.
I have a dream.
You can't handle the truth.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Though we march to the music of our time, our mission is timeless.
The big idea was throw as many little ideas out there right away. So it's like, I get it. We started with all these little ideas to make sure everyone knew what I was doing. We knew we were going to end with Bohemian Rhapsody. We knew that was going to be the perfect for this ensemble with all their personality. We're going to have a lot of fun with it. And then we had a million ideas for in between.
Right.
So at that point, the beginning and the end dictated sort of where we were going to go with all this.
Right.
We also didn't want to be so serious the whole show and then all of a sudden drop the Bohemian bomb and for it just to feel super out of place.
Right.
So there's something about that. Like, well, we have these six ideas. So maybe that somewhere in here we should allude to the personality of the group and the direction of the show, so it's not just shocking
right
by the time we get there. And then, of course, it's like, well, which ideas make the most sense?
Some things last forever.
We knew we had a really strong front ensemble, so that's, you know, part of it. Any good show design is playing to your strengths.
Mm-hmm.
And with a very old, like senior heavy front ensemble, very talented group, we're like, okay, we want to do the craziest pit run. We want to go for it. We want to do it. What are we going to do?
Yeah. So in summertime, I had sent him a video and it was like, hey man, I know you're kind of new to the whole scene, new, but didn't grow up geeking out on DCI. And I was like, right. You've seen this, right? And he was like, holy crap, what is that? Like, that's the Blue Devil 2000 run, man. You should know that. And we then I called him up a couple days later and I was like, we should do something like that in the show. It's outrageous. And I was like, or we should just do that. Or maybe you said that. And it was like,
yeah.
Oh yeah, or we should just do it because then it's even more timeless.
Important decision, because now that's a, like a milestone within the show that's also creating like, okay, that needs to happen here. We know we're gonna have the oh yeah, we know we're gonna have Bohemian, and we know we have this mashup of sound bites to set the tone for the show. Now what else can we fit in here?
And then is it just gonna be one arrangement,
right?
Like, so random, once again, Bohemian just shows up and it's like, okay, what about the ballad, what about the downtime? Oh, Adagio for strings. Oh, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like the show almost writes itself because of the concept.
Yeah, when John brought up the idea of using Adagio for strings, I was really excited because that piece in and of itself is a strings piece, and it's been used in so many movies and everyone knows it. But doing it with a percussion ensemble is really interesting because the piece itself is just long whole notes, double whole notes. But to be able to put mallet parts in there and make it work. But then we were like, well, why are we doing Adagio for strings other than it sounds great? What's the concept?
Yeah, and we didn't even fully know that until we were explaining it to the kids. And this always happens. Like sometimes we're like, this show's great, everything makes sense, and everyone's excited, and we get to a spot where we're like, and then we're gonna do Adagio for strings because it's gonna be cool.
It's everyone knows the piece. It's really famous.
And the kids are like,
it sounds good.
Then we're gonna do Bohemian Rhapsody, and everyone's excited. So then we're like, all right, we need to have a bigger conversation about Adagio for strings. We can't just rely on the music. So then we came up with this idea of this kind of juxtaposition where you've seen it in the movies where they do like a whole war scene or platoon and everyone knows that. But there's been a lot of that recently in the activity, so we didn't want to just do that. Then we kind of came up with this like super classic coach locker room hype speech from a few different movies, a little bit of Rocky, a little bit of that. And then we have this big moment where there's like the locker room huddle. And everyone's right. Down, you got the one guy, and he's like, I believe in you, you know, trust in me. And everyone starts just hyping, and it grows, and it's that locker room excitement. And that kind of dives right into the big battery build, and we're still able to have like this big musical long build, but it makes sense more than just playing Adagio. It's like the energy coming out of this huddle that blows up all over the floor and ends with this big resolution.
All comes down to today, inch by inch, play by play, till we're finished. Forget about the crowds, the size of the school, their fancy uniforms. But it ain't about how hard you hit, it's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward.
Any designer falls victim to, we've done it multiple times, we call it falling down the rabbit hole. And that's when you've gotten so deep into your outline and so entrenched in the ideas and you've become so close to the show before it even comes to reality that you can't hear anyone else's opinion. And it's really important to be able to come out of the rabbit hole and not to be too married to anything if enough people are adversely reacting to it.
Oh, you know, a lot of the time this happens to us. You get that, you go to that first show and the GE judge, like, stupid GE judge. What's wrong with him? How do you not get everything that we're doing?
Second show, stupid GE judge.
WGI regional, double panel, all the judges. And it's like, wait a minute. You know, and a lot of time it's just about pointing, like really making sure you're pointing everyone in the right direction. Hopefully your foundation is strong. You can't be afraid about making changes. You just can't. Like we, you know, last year, the 2012 Chino Hills show, we late in the season, we went through the whole thing deep. Like it was like a couple weeks before finals, changed all the narration that helped point it along. And we did that. We threw it out of one local show and all of a sudden we didn't change any of the drill or music or anything. Nope. And the judge was like, oh, I get it. It's so easy. And we're like, oh, that's all it took.
We were about halfway down the rabbit hole thinking that everything made sense. And when we came out of the rabbit hole, we actually looked at what we were doing like, uh-oh, let's get all the way out of here.
Our mission is timeless.
So to wrap up, with all the information that you have in front of you when you're going to do your outline, the most important thing is just keep focus on the structure and form of your show. You gotta have your beginning, you gotta have your end, and you need to have great events in between, but they also have to flow really well from beginning to end. It has to be a natural process for the audience member to see all of that happening, for the show to come across as successful and logical and something that's entertaining for the crowd.